Why am I so violent in the beginning? Thank you to Brilliant for sponsoring a portion of this video. At the end of 2019, two companies called Healthy Mice and Beyond Verbal merged to become Vocalis. Their aim is to use these things called vocal biomarkers to suss out if people have particular diseases or disorders. And vocal biomarkers is just a scientific way of saying features of your voice. The idea is that if the development of certain disorders can be detected or even predicted from just a voice recording, then this could be a way to screen patients. A non-invasive, high-throughput way of picking out people who may need further examination, like an audio blood test. There are already some diseases where physicians and doctors can hear a change in their patient's voice with their naked ear, but this is about interrogating beyond that and to find kind of data that backs up whether there are particular voice prints for different diseases. The tech works by running thousands of voice recordings through a machine learning algorithm. These algorithms then pick out certain qualities or features in the person's speech. Correlations are then made between vocal features and certain disorders. Now, I'm not going to go into too much detail on those algorithms themselves, but if you're interested in learning more about machine learning or algorithms or artificial intelligence, then I recommend checking out Jordan Harrod's channel after you've watched this video. And if you do, go say hello to her, you know, tell her I sent you. Now, I hadn't really heard much about the use of vocal biomarkers before I started researching for this video, but once I started researching for this video, I realised that it's kind of a field and an area that a lot of scientists are pretty excited about. You know, if there's one thing that scientists and farmers have in common, it's that they love a new field, and the field of vocal diagnostics is no different in that regard. There are loads of different diseases and disorders that these vocal biomarkers have been tied to, and to me, some make a bit more sense than others. But in this video, I'm going to particularly go through, in this order, Parkinson's, Alzheimer's, PTSD, and then COPD and COVID, with COPD being chronic obstructive pulmonary disorder and COVID being all that anybody is talking about. And little spoiler alert here, the graph of how clear and, dare I say, legit the relationship is between these different disorders and their relative biomarkers, as I go along the list, kind of goes like this. And that's because whilst algorithms pick out correlations, they're not as good at pointing out what the potential causes of that connection may be. You know, it's one thing having an algorithm take in a load of information and then spit out a pattern. That's a great explanation of machine learning there, Soph. But it's another thing working out what that connection actually means. So we have to try and work out that causal reasoning for ourselves. Speeding through the first half of that list then, number one is Parkinson's. 43 people, 33 of whom had Parkinson's, were recorded going ah. From that, an algorithm identified 10 vocal features as being associated with Parkinson's, including breathiness and tremulous oscillations in pitch, aka a kind of wobbliness. Using these 10 vocal features, researchers could then identify which speech samples had come from someone with Parkinson's with 99% accuracy. Causation-wise, this one is reasonably clear. I've spoken about Parkinson's a lot on this channel, but it's essentially a disease that affects how well you have control over your muscles, and that includes muscles that control your vocal cords. Lost control for a second then. So it makes sense that Parkinson's will potentially affect your voice. Next up, number two on the list, we have Alzheimer's. In a study in 2015, 167 people with possible or probable Alzheimer's had their voice recordings compared to people without Alzheimer's. Rather than looking solely at the quality and characteristics of these people's voices, the algorithm also was fed a transcript so they could look at their vocabulary. It was found that those with suspected Alzheimer's tended to use shorter words, more fragmented sentences, and they repeated themselves more. They also generally used pronouns to describe things, so they said it or that rather than saying the name of the thing itself. Using 35 vocal characteristics, the system could detect who had possible or probable Alzheimer's to about 82% accuracy. And according to a Nature News article that I've linked below, that has since increased to 92%. So what about causation then? Well, just as the Parkinson's example had a clear muscular reasoning behind it, the Alzheimer's example has a pretty logical neurological or brain-based explanation. Alzheimer's affects people's cognitive abilities, and so it makes sense that their sentence structure will be impacted more than how their voice sounds. So for example, using more pronouns to talk about things rather than the names of the specific things they're talking about suggests that they may have forgotten some of the names of the things that they're talking about. Now, as Parkinson's and Alzheimer's are both neurodegenerative disorders where the brain wears away over time, then anything that may allow for potential earlier diagnosis is of vital importance, something I've discussed since the dawn of this channel. And this is why these two examples are kind of two of the key ones in this area of vocal biomarker research. Because, you know, the earlier we detect the diseases, the more likely we'll be able to intervene before they do too much damage. Thirdly, comes a more unusual case. Investigating post-traumatic stress disorder, or PTSD. A study from December 2018 used an algorithm to identify 18 vocal features associated with PTSD in 129 male military veterans. Those features included things like slower and more monotonous speech. Using these features, the system could predict who had PTSD with 90% accuracy. But causation-wise, this paper doesn't really question the causes too deeply. It more skims over some potentials, including talking a bit about muscle tension and a little bit about the neurotransmitter GABA, which also has some connections to muscle tone. In general though, we're getting into like less solid ground causation-wise, especially compared to the previous two examples of Alzheimer's and Parkinson's. As I mentioned earlier, there are lots more studies looking at vocal biomarkers in lots more diseases and disorders, ranging from coronary artery disease to ADHD, from depression to autism. But these all kind of fall, as far as I'm concerned, on the less certain of a causal link side of the situation. I'm not going to go into all of those, but I've linked a few studies below if you want to peruse them. What I want to get onto now is talking about voice diagnostics in reference to COPD and COVID, and I'm going to talk about them together because they're kind of linked. Before I do that though, I just need to kind of reference the kind of small group sizes from those examples I gave earlier, because despite all of this buzz around vocal diagnostics and how it's quite an exciting area, I'm sorry everyone, it's time to hold your horses. Come here, you. Whilst the field of vocal biomarkers is one that's developing quickly and one that a lot of scientists seem well excited about, there's still quite a lot more research to be done. Huge sample sizes are needed. Even the 167 people in that Alzheimer's study isn't very many when you consider just how variable our voices are. For these vocal diagnostic tools to work, you're going to need examples of people's voices with all sorts of different accents, from all sorts of different places in the world, all sorts of different qualities of voice, and speaking all sorts of different languages. Even ignoring the language thing, an ill person in Liverpool is gonna sound completely different to an ill person in New York. Heck, they're gonna sound completely different to an ill person on the other side of Liverpool. Have you heard Liverpudlian accents? I mean, I sound totally different depending on whether I'm in the north or the south, or if my notes have flared up. And that all doesn't even consider how variable the qualities of different people's microphones are, if we're gonna do this whole record from home and send it to your doctor thing. This need for studying large numbers, however, is what brings me right back to Vocalis. Or Vocalis, I don't know. As soon as I say Vocalis, it sounds kind of, I don't know, like an ancient fairy. Vocalis were initially concerned with spotting COPD, or chronic obstructive pulmonary disorder, as I mentioned earlier. It's a disease of the lungs, so it's not a surprise that when it flares up, that's going to have an impact on your voice. Vocalis claimed that their voice analysis technology could detect if current COPD patients were about to have a flare-up a few days before it happened. However, at the beginning of this year, the SARS-CoV-2 virus, aka the coronavirus, came along and gave Vocalis a new avenue to explore. Wait, let me get this straight. It's a virus that infects your lungs, mm-hmm. right?
Mm-hmm.
And it's making life more and more remote, including doctor's visits.
Yes.
Hmm. So, of course, they pivoted and started focusing more energy on sussing out if there are vocal biomarkers for COVID. They believe that the symptoms of fever, cough, and shortness of breath can be logged through voice tasks such as phonation and free speech. Listen, it's just my opinion, okay? If I want to, I should be allowed to be racist. No, I said free speech, not hate speech. You see, it's more like describing how your day's going. Vocalists aren't the only team chasing vocal biomarkers for COVID, though. According to that Nature News feature that I mentioned earlier, and that is linked below, at least three other research groups are hot on their heels. We await with bated breath to see if there are any results from any of them. Is that the hold music while waiting for a research result? Rather than simply waiting, however, you can get involved. That's right, even though Vocalis may only have 3 followers on Twitter, 4 now, according to their website, they have vocal data already from around 50,000 people. This is a pretty shiny number, but as I said earlier, huge sample sizes are needed for something like this to work. And in total, they want to enroll double that number in their study. They want the vocal data from 100,000 people. They want as many English-speaking people as possible to lend them their voices, donc c'est ce que je vais faire. Oh, English speaking, sorry. So that's what I'm gonna do. Vocalis actually have a consent form on their website that you can read through and kind of see what you're getting yourself into. And it actually kind of confused me more than anything else at first, because it mentioned lots of different disorders and diseases that I guess they've tried in the past or are trying now to find vocal biomarkers for. But I just figured that this was a more general consent form for their studies generally, and all I really wanted was some reassurance on the security of it all in my voice, which I got. It's reassurance I got from both their website and from the consent form, so it was all good. I'm glad I got that reassurance, because the co-founder of the company is literally called Shady. I'm sure he's a real slim stand-up guy. It's also all approved by an institutional review board, which is a requirement for clinical research. So, you know, I was all good to go. I went on my merry way with it. So the way it works is you log on to a survey that you can find on their website, and they take recordings of your voice for about 10 minutes. The consent form had pre-warned me of some of the kind of questions to expect, like name as many animals as you can in a minute, capuchin, alligator, beast. And how has your day been? Which I was quite looking forward to, because you know, it's always nice when someone cares. But another sign that the website and the consent form are slightly different, I didn't get asked either of those things. Instead, I described a picture, their other sibling is looking at them, and they're all smiling and happy, like a nuclear family that is full of joy and happiness. And counted from 50 to 70, because you know, 1 to 20 is so passé. After this 10-minute session, they said they'd be in touch in the future for kind of follow-up sessions. And according to their website, this will be kind of 2 to 3 minute long recordings once a week for the next 3 weeks, if I want to do them. And there we go, that's it. I did a science. It's important to note that in all the examples I've given in this video, vocal biomarkers are never intended to replace current diagnostic methods. They're there to inform, to add a fast and non-invasive tool to our diagnostic arsenal, and to narrow the stream of potential people who may need an in-person test. They could also potentially provide a running analysis of how someone's symptoms are developing through individual recordings, like the burst feature on a camera, but for voices. But even when not being used as the sole method of diagnosis, there's still a lot of questions that remain, from doubts about privacy to doubts about accuracy and repeatability across worldwide voices. And so moving from proof of concept studies to an actual product isn't going to be a smooth ride. So I guess I'd summarise by saying this is quite an exciting field, but it's still in its preliminary stages, from my point of view. The whole reason, though, that we can have such exciting prospects as these non-invasive, easily rolloutable technologies is thanks to advancements in areas like machine learning and algorithm use. To be honest, my relationship with these fields is kind of threefold. Like, one, I've always found them a bit mysterious. 2, I'm finding them increasingly necessary to learn about and understand, and 3, I've always assumed that they would be really hard to understand. But artificial intelligence and things like that seem to be coming up more and more, both in the academic papers that I read and the conversations I have, but also in things that I interact with in my life. So in making this video, I decided to bite the bullet and learn a bit more about machine learning, and I did that with Brilliant's machine learning course. As you may know, Brilliant have an app and a website where you can learn science and maths in a completely non-intimidating but very dynamic way. You just work through at your own pace, completing quizzes and challenges. As I've said before, the main thing that I really like about Brilliant is that you learn by doing and challenging yourself rather than by kind of rote learning something and then having a memory test at the end, which, let's be honest, is kind of what most standard education is like these days. So in parallel to creating this video, I've also been educating myself more on the topic that's central to it. It was great actually, because when I was researching papers, like phrases like regression trees would come up and then I'd see them on the course. Did you know that when you do a bunch of regression tree analyses, they call it a random forest algorithm? Love that arboreal lingo. So in a world where machine learning and algorithms and artificial intelligence seem to be popping up more and more, if you want to inform yourself on those topics, then you can sign up for free at brilliant.org/sophsnotes. And the first 200 of you to click on that link will get 20% off your annual premium subscription. Tasty. But otherwise, that is it for now. But before my usual spiel and like it if you like it, yada yada yada, I have a little request. If you are subscribed to me and you feel like you like what I do, then that is wonderful enough. But I realise that I've never asked anyone to press the little bell notification button thing, probably because I don't even know what to call it. But apparently asking for that helps. So hey, if you haven't pressed the little bell notification button thing yet, please go ahead. Otherwise, like this video if you like it, share if you share it, subscribe if you subscribe it, and comment if you have any thoughts. Also, media my socials if you want to do that. In terms of the comment, why don't you tell me, do you have a particularly changeable voice? What do you think of this whole voice analysis shenanigans, plural? Otherwise, all that's left to say is thank you, yes you, so much for watching, have a lovely day, and remember to keep checking if it's correlation or causation. Was a sciencey one this time. And a big old thank you to my wonderful patrons, with a special shout out to Adam Dullinger, Terry Cox and Justin Brown. Good start. Good start. Good start, so great. To suss out if people have to lend them their voices, donc c'est ça que fait, je vais faire. I don't want to sound like Joey in Friends when he's like blah 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 blah. I'm not Emily in Paris, guys, I'm trying. You're my microphone and I'm checking that you're working, checking that you're working for me. I think my mic's working, yeah. The consent warm. Wait, so let me get... The end is nigh, the end is here. Here's a video that I picked out especially for you, here's a playlist of my favourites, and here's a Patreon link if you want to see me acting like even more of a goof.